today. Special welcome to those of you gathering online, wherever you happen to be. God's blessings to you as well. As we gather here today in the name of God, no matter where we gather, we recognize that God's gifts are available to us. Through the good news of Jesus' word itself, through the presence of His Holy Spirit dwelling with His people, God is always at work within us. So I pray that today God gets to do some work in you. If you're a worship guest with us today, whether you're joining us online or joining us here in person, I'd like to invite you to grab one of those purple cards out of the pew rack in front of you, take it home with you. It may answer some questions for you, maybe help connect some dots and make some connections that would help you in some way. The rest of you, I mean, including our guests, if you'd like to fill out one of those yellow cards too, just some information if you'd like to share. Certainly some prayer requests are available on that as well. A couple of announcements to draw your attention to. Today's being the last day we'll be collecting nominations for the associate pastor position. We're about ready to communicate with the district our desires and our requests really for an associate pastor. We're going to call from the field somewhere. So if there's an individual who's a good fit, we thank for faith that you happen to be aware of, please note that on that nomination form and get that back into the office by tomorrow. Tomorrow's the deadline for that, I believe December 7th. Secondly, we're starting our Advent celebration, and we meet together on Wednesdays. There's a service at 12:15 if you can get away from work at lunchtime, or to come in at 7 p.m. We're talking really about prepare the way, and it's an opportunity for us to kind of slow ourselves down a little bit and come together for worship on Wednesdays. So 12:15, 7 p.m. One other announcement is Christmas Eve. I talked about this last week. There'll be four services at Christmas Eve. 10 o'clock is still open. The other three are really at capacity of what we think is probable for us when we deal with all the social distancing aspects. So if you would still like to come and be here in person on Christmas Eve, the 10 p.m. service is available. We will, of course, be streaming, I believe, the 6 o'clock service again on Facebook. So for those of you watching us right now and those of you that are here, we will be streaming. By the way, we stream the Advent services as well and all those things. So to keep as much connection going as possible. If you haven't picked up an Advent devotional, there's still some available out there on the table. I put those together for you all so that we can help kind of keep this theme of prepare the way, continuing going through. I've got some very kind feedback from some of you about them. I'm glad you're using them, and I'm glad they're a blessing. So they're also available online for those of you that are home. Go to the website. There's a button for that as well. Okay. I'm glad that we're all here together. Would you celebrate being together here in the body of Christ? Would you rise up? Could you give a little wave or a wink to the people around you? Big smile and a welcome this morning. Let's remain standing as we sing.
Thank you.
and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Let us profess our faith in who God has revealed himself to be, triune, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And let's use the words of the Apostles' Creed. If you need those, they'll be up on the screens. Let us profess together.
I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Amen. I want to invite the congregation to please be seated. We have just professed the faith that God himself has gifted to us. And so as we are made aware of God's holiness, we must become aware of our sinfulness. And so let's take this opportunity to confess our sin before God. And so I want to invite you, if you'd like to take up the posture of a repentant people. Maybe slide forward where you're seated, holding your hand over the pew in front of you. And let's speak these words of confession you'll find either in the bulletin or up on the screens. Let's confess our sin together.
Please hear my confession, O God. I, poor sinner, plead guilty before you of all sins. I have lived as if you did not matter, and as if I had repulsed. Your name I have not honored as I should. My worship
First reading is from Isaiah chapter 40. Comfort, comfort, my people, says your God. Speak tenderly to Jerusalem and cry to her that her warfare is ended, that her iniquity is pardoned, that she has received from the Lord's hand double for all her sins. A voice cries in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make straight in the desert a highway for our God. Every valley shall be lifted up, and every mountain and hill be made low. The uneven ground shall become level, and the rough places a plain. And the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all flesh shall see it together, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken. A voice says, cry, and I said, what shall I cry? All flesh is grass, and all its beauty is like the flower of the field. The grass withers, the flower fades, when the breath of the Lord blows on it. Surely the people are grass. The grass withers, the flower fades, but the word of our God will stand forever. Go on up to a high mountain, O Zion, herald of good news. Lift up your voice with strength, O Jerusalem, herald of good news. Lift it up, fear not, Say to the cities of Judah, behold your God. Behold, the Lord God comes with might, and his arm rules for him. Behold, his reward is with him, and his recompense before him. He will tend his flock like a shepherd. He will gather the lambs in his arms. He will carry them in his bosom, and gently lead those that are with young. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The second reading is from 2 Peter chapter 3. But do not overlook this one fact, beloved, that with the Lord one day is as 1,000 years, and 1,000 years as one day. The Lord is not slow to fulfill his promise, as some count slowness, but is patient toward you, not wishing that any should perish, but that all shall reach repentance. But the day of the Lord will come like a thief, and then the heavens will pass away with a roar, and the heavenly bodies will be burned up and dissolved, and the earth and the works that are done on it will be exposed. Since all these things are thus to be dissolved, what sort of people ought you be in the lives of holiness and godliness, waiting for and hastening the coming of the day of God, because of which the heavens will be set on fire and dissolved, and the heavenly bodies will melt as they burn. But according to his promise, we are waiting for new heavens and a new earth in which righteousness dwells. Therefore, beloved, since you are waiting for these, be diligent to be found by him without spot or blemish and at peace. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand out of respect for Jesus and his word.
Thank you.
Good and gracious Heavenly Father, we ask for your promised presence, through the gift of your Holy Spirit, that you would grant us not only understanding, but Lord, I pray a zeal to live as your church. Send us forth from this place, Lord, to make an impact, a difference in this world of ours. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. God's grace, God's mercy, and God's peace to you. From God our Father and from our Lord and our Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. I want to direct your attention, as I always do, to your bulletin. There's an outline there that's going to follow along with some fill-ins you'll see up on the screen. And maybe there's something that we talk about, something that's said today that will help you, not only now, but maybe in the coming days, even weeks. It may help you in a conversation that you have. Maybe it's a way that God's going to use what we do here today and cause change in your life. Underneath the outline, there's a series of Bible readings that are there. Those are there really as an encouragement. I know how important it is to be in the Word of God each and every day. And so if you're not in that habit, there's a list of readings there, six of them, one for each day between now and next Sunday, to really build into you what we talk about. So it takes the same subject as the sermon and continues to walk it through. I imagine many of you would be a little uncomfortable seeing a picture like this, someone that's carrying a sign like that. It's a little out of the ordinary. It's a little different. It usually equates, in my mind, to someone who's maybe a little less than balanced mentally. People that carry signs like that are often speaking loudly, even yelling about the world, the end of the world, and Judgment Day. They attract a fair amount of attention. But people avoid them. We probably would avoid them. People like this make us uncomfortable. So this morning we're going to deal with this word, repent. The very word repent rocks the boat. Repent means dealing with our sin. We don't want to most of the time because it's embarrassing. It's humiliating. It brings shame and guilt about what we've done. I mean, come on, Pastor, can't we just sing our favorite Christmas songs and not be uncomfortable? Well, I have good news for you. In fact, the Gospel of Mark has good news for you. He begins his Gospel not with the account of Jesus' birth. In fact, Mark doesn't deal with the birth of Jesus at all. He begins with the proclamation from an unusual man in unusual attire, shouting an unusual message. But church, this is the beginning of the good news. In Mark 1:1, again, it says, the beginning of the gospel of Jesus Christ. It's the beginning of the gospel. And the beginning of the gospel of the good news is preparation. Prepare the way of the Lord. And John the Baptist's recipe for preparation begins with repentance. And so John came, baptizing in the desert region and preaching a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. How many of us, though, really like preparing? During this holiday season, we spend a great deal of time preparing. From trees and trimmings to Christmas lights and Christmas cookies, to dinners and decorations, to ornaments, and an inordinate amount of time dedicated to preparation. But how many of us actually enjoy preparing for things? I, personally, I like finished products. I like my house decorated with Christmas lights. I don't like getting up on a ladder on the roof to do it. I like eating the traditional Glen Hill Christmas cookies, but the 3 hours it takes to decorate them tires me out. I love to have people over when I can, but the work that it takes maybe to prepare the house, not our favorite thing to do. You see, we like wonderful dinners, ice cakes, decorated Christmas trees, clean homes, and well-behaved children. We don't necessarily like the preparations. We like the finished product. But church life, this life, is all about preparation. And I'm obviously speaking about the life that is to come. Advent reminds us of that. You see, too often I believe Advent is a season we think is the subtle party leading up to the big event of Christmas. That is not the purpose of Advent. It is a season about preparation, but not for Christmas. It never has been. Listen to the words again, first spoken by the prophet of Isaiah, and then repeated by John the Baptist, as Kristen read just moments ago. Isaiah 40, verse 3. Prepare the way of the Lord. In Mark, it said John the Baptist was preaching a message of repentance in preparation for Jesus' arrival. So for us, Jesus is coming again. He's returning. And so we're called to prepare for his arrival, albeit his second. And the message is still the same. Repent. And since this season begins with repentance, we tend to avoid that word. And so we may see people standing on street corners in crowded places carrying signs like these. And they talk loudly about God and Jesus and judgment. But as Christians, we see people like this and we kind of apologize and say, we're not like that. My question is, church, why aren't we like that? Why isn't that our message? If it is the first word of the gospel, if it is the beginning of the good news, why don't we have the zeal of a sign like that proclaimed to this world? Repent. Maybe it seems out of step with peace on earth, goodwill toward men, brotherhood and merriment and gift-giving and family celebration. But it's the beginning of the good news of Jesus Christ. And the good news begins with repentance. You see, repent is a bold message. You see, the message of John the Baptist was not the same message that the people of his time were accustomed to. The Jews in John's audience had grown accustomed to their religious lives, going through the motions, doing just enough to keep the priests off their back, giving offerings out of obligation. I wonder if any of that sounds familiar to us. And then comes this overdue prophet who heralds the Messiah who is coming, and that this Messiah demands change. You see, the people of John's time and we have gotten comfortable. Repenting is often something we only dabble in, usually only scratching the surface of our lives. In fact, when we repent, I believe we are rarely honest, barely sincere, and rarely do we disclose the real sin in our lives. But John was no salesman, sweet-talking the people into repenting. And he was no politician trying to match his words with what is popular opinion of his time, and nor should we. You see, John the Baptist was the fulfillment of a 700-year-old prophecy, that forbidding Isaiah, that a messenger would come heralding the arrival of the Messiah. In Mark 1, 2, and 3, it says, I will send my messenger ahead of you, who will prepare your way, a voice of one calling in the desert. Prepare the way for the Lord, make straight paths for him. And so for the people of God of John's time, it had been a long wait, a drought, since the Jews had heard anything from God. They were still waiting for this promised Messiah. In fact, from the Old Testament prophet Malachi, chapter 3, it says, see, I will send my messenger who will prepare the way before me. The people of Mark's time were still waiting for this messenger. And by the time that the ink actually dried on the scroll of Malachi, the last Old Testament prophet, it was still 400 years before the messenger actually appeared in the desert of Judea, preaching a message of repentance. And like those of his time, this message of repentance, it makes us uncomfortable. Because repenting isn't simple. It's more than being sorry. It's turning away from sin and turning toward God. When I was a boy and would occasionally get into altercations with one or all of my three brothers, my mother would insist that when it began to escalate and someone would get angry or someone would get hurt, my mom said, "Well, you need to go and tell the other person that you're sorry. And then I want you to give them a hug." Now, pardon the pun, but it was not long before my brothers and I fully embraced this attitude. You see, when something happened and there was a disagreement and somebody got hurt, I would step in, my sainted mother, and she would say, "Tell her you're sorry and give them a hug." Naturally, we would say, "I'm sorry," and we'd wrap our arms around them, and we'd squeeze them for all that we were worth. I think the goal was to remove all the air out of them first before they did it to you. But you see, church, this word repentance, this message of John the Baptist, this important step in the preparation of Jesus' return is not simply being sorry. You see, my brothers and I, we said we were sorry. But we didn't feel any different. We felt a lot of pain, maybe, but we didn't feel different in that relationship. It is imperative to understand John the Baptist's message. You see, there is an urgency. Repent. The end is near, and Jesus' return is close. In fact, you get that it's closer today than it was yesterday. Repentance means to change the way you think. Hence the U-turn today. So it's being sorry, but it's being sorry enough to change. I think this is an important distinction for us this morning. There's two kinds of repentance. There's worldly repentance and there is godly repentance. Now, worldly repentance is when you're sorry because of the consequences. Like when I was a boy and I got in trouble, I was sorry that I got caught. And it usually meant that I would sin more carefully next time. But godly repentance, it's about recognizing that the relationship with God has been damaged. And then there's a desire to change. Godly repentance goes much deeper. Recognizing that something is broken and that affects everything around us. It's about being more concerned about the effect that the sin has on our relationship with God than on the actual sin itself. Church, the difference boils down to this: whose way? Who's in charge of our lives? And so this is why the preparation, the repenting is so important, because Jesus is coming back. Now, I'll tell you that the message of John the Baptist was not unique. It was actually Jesus' first sermon. In Matthew 4, verse 17, it says, "From that time on, Jesus began to preach." What message did he send? "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is near." It was the message of Jesus' disciples when they went out. In Mark 6, they went out and preached that people should repent. As Jesus was sending out his followers, he gave them these marching orders in Luke 24. He told them, "This is what is written. The Christ will suffer and rise from the dead on the third day, and repentance and forgiveness of sins will be preached in his name to all nations." And then we know it was effective because later on it was the proclamation of the disciple Peter speaking to a group of people in Jerusalem after Jesus was crucified and raised. In Acts 2, Peter replied, "Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. It was also the message of Paul to the Gentiles. I have declared to both Jews and Greeks that they must turn to God in repentance and have faith in our Lord Jesus. So, church, the message of repentance is not just the message of an unusual man in unusual attire in the desert of Judea, nor is it the message of unusual people standing on crowded street corners holding up signs. This message is to be proclaimed and lived out by every follower of Jesus in preparation for his return. Repent. It's the first word of the gospel. Church, we can repent, and we have already this morning, with great confidence, because Jesus Christ has come. Born as a baby in Bethlehem, grew into a man with a message that people weren't expecting. And his message was also about repenting. And his message angered people, in fact, some people so much that they crucified him on a cross. And there he died. But in that death, he washed us of our sins. He removed our punishment and he forgave us. And so the message, church, is repent. Because Jesus is coming soon. It is the first word of the good news. And when we ask for forgiveness, he grants us grace, he offers us new life in him, and we respond by seeking to live a life that reflects our joy in that good news. You see, when we repent, we are preparing. So, church, prepare the way of the Lord. In the name of Jesus Christ, our risen Lord and Savior. Amen. So this morning, we'll gather our tithes and our offerings as we have done, as our habit here as of late. Is as you are ushered forward to receive the Lord's Supper, I'd ask you to bring your offerings forward. Drop them here in the prayer well here at the front of the aisle. For those of you that are tuning in at home, I would encourage you to continue to send those in or drop them by. Come by sometimes. We would love to see you, look at your face, and see your smiling face. Also, if you have filled out one of those communication cards, one of those yellow cards, bring those up with your offering. Place those in the prayer well. Any information that's changed for you, please note that on there for us. I'm also very interested in any prayer requests that you have, anything that's going on in your life, things you want to thank God for, ask God for. Please note that in the little blanks available at the bottom of that yellow card and place those in the prayer well, and those will come to me, and just know that you will be prayed for, and I pray joining you in prayer throughout this coming week. In our prayers, we'll lift up those that God has placed on our hearts. By the way, those names are listed in the bulletin for your sake. Right? Even though we pray for them on Sunday, and we do pray when prayer group comes together on Wednesday here at church, but I want to remind you that they are there for you to pray for. And so take your bulletin home, put it somewhere where you can find it, and lift up those people in prayer. You don't have to know the situation. You just have to ask God to be involved. And so as we pray today, I pray this just gets you started in the direction of lifting these people up for prayer. Following each petition, I'll speak the phrase, Lord, in your mercy. I want to invite you to respond boldly and confidently. Hear our prayer. And following the prayers for the people of God, we'll pray the Lord's Prayer. If you need those words, they'll be on the screens as well. Will you please stand? Let us go before the Lord in prayer. Good and gracious Heavenly Father, remind us today what repentance is. Remind us that it is a time for us to turn away from the sin in our lives and turn toward you where we receive healing and help and strength to resist those sins. just being sorry. Convict us of that. Let us not just give lip service to what repentance is into practice. Lord, may it transform us into people that seek to live a different life because you have called us your own. Lord, in your mercy. Heavenly Father, we pray for those that are in need of your help and healing. And so this morning, we lift up to you by name Elizabeth and John and Regina and Paul and Jean, Fred and JR and Marlene. Lord, I pray all those that are also names on our hearts right now that are even now unspoken out loud. Lord, I do pray as you call us to ask. I pray for healing and help. Pray for those that are struggling with illness, whether it's COVID or the flu, cancer, sickness, or brokenness. Lord, if it is your will, bring wholeness and healing to their bodies. But Lord, if it is not your will, at this moment, I pray that you would grant them a deepened and more convicted faith, that they would learn from you, that they would learn from this struggle. And Lord, they would gain new insight according to your will. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Heavenly Father, I pray for our country. Lord, is there such unrest in our country that, Lord, it's not going to be solved by politicians. It's not going to even be solved by societal change and things like that. It's going to be solved by your truth and love through your church. And so, Lord, may we encourage our leaders. May we encourage our neighbors, but Lord, may we be the objects of change. And so, Lord, where there is racial tension, where there is ethnicity tension, where there is national tension, where there is political tension and divisiveness, Lord, may your church be the loudest voice, not be the sleeping giant that we have been accused of. But Lord, may we proclaim your truth and love to a world that desperately needs it. Lord, in your mercy. And so, Lord, I pray for resolution. Resolution in our politics, in our leadership, in the previous vote. That, Lord, that you would bring wholeness to this country. Lord, that you would bring healing, not only in emotional, but physical from this virus. Lord, I pray for healing in relationships that have been damaged because of quarantines and separation. I pray for comfort and peace in a country that has had a challenging year. But again, Lord, the truth and the hope comes from only one place. Not a president, not a Congress, not physical health, but the one who walked out of the tomb. Remind us of that this season. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Finally, Lord, I pray your blessing upon those who protect us and keep us safe. For those that serve in our military, whether it is near or far, watch over them. Protect them as they protect us. Lord, for those locally that watch over and are servants of yours to us, for our law enforcement, fire department, EMS, Lord, walk with them, surround them with your holy angels to keep them safe, that they may execute their tasks with integrity, with honesty, Lord, and with love. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Heavenly Father, all these things, we ask in the name of Jesus, who has also taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Part of our preparation for receiving the very presence of God today in this meal, we've already done. We've repented of our sin, and you have received the proclamation of God's forgiveness. And so let's now welcome the very presence of God into this meal, that he promises to meet us, to heal us, and to strengthen us. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and singing.
Thank you.
Now may this, the true body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, strengthen and preserve you to life everlasting. Receive now the blessing of our Lord. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you with his favor and give you his peace. Ushered in, leaving from the back to the front. May God bless your week.